हेलो एंड वेलकम एवरीवन। आई होप एवरीवन इज़ कीपिंग सेफ इन दिस COVID-19 पेंडेमिक। कमिंग टू द टॉपिक आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग टुडे, इट्स वेरिएशन इन द आरबीसी मॉर्फोलॉजी। नाउ टू स्टडी द मॉर्फोलॉजी ऑफ आरबीसी थ्रू द जनरल ब्लड पिक्चर, इट इज़ इम्पॉर्टेंट बिकॉज इट गिव्स अस आर आइडिया और क्लू अबाउट द क्लिनिकल कंडीशन ऑफ द पेशेंट। सो इट इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू स्टडी द आरबीसी मॉर्फोलॉजी and we do it by examining the peripheral blood smear or the general blood picture. So before going on to the main topic, we know that the RBCs, they are produced by the process of hematopoiesis, which occurs in the intrauterine life in the yolk sac by the third week, and by the third month it occurs in the liver, and by the fourth month the hematopoiesis occurs in the bone marrow. And when a child is born, the hematopoiesis occurs entirely in the bone marrow, and at the time of birth all the marrow in our body, it is the red marrow, but by puberty at the various sites this red marrow gets replaced by the yellow marrow, and only in the few sites like the ends of long bones or the flat bones like the sternum or the ribs or the spine of the vertebra or the skull bones, in all these bones the process, the red marrow remains, and the rest part of the body it is replaced by the yellow marrow. So in the hematopoiesis, the hematopoietic stem cell, which is CD34 positive, so that will give rise to the various precursor cells. Like for RBC, the precursor cell is the proerythroblast. Now it has a fine chromatin, prominent nucleoli, and scanty cytoplasm. Then there are three stages of normoblast. But one is early normoblast, intermediate normoblast, and the late normoblast. So the early normoblast, also known as the basophilic normoblast, the chromatin is more condensed as compared to the proerythroblast. There is no nucleoli, and there is scanty to moderate cytoplasm, which is basophilic. So it is also known as basophilic normoblast. Then comes the polychromatic normoblast. Now here the cytoplasm has got a pinkish tinge to it because the hemoglobinization has started. Now this is an important point, that hemoglobin synthesis can be seen by the Romanowski stains in this stage, which is the polychromatic normoblast or the intermediate normoblast. Now chromatin, it is more condensed than the basophilic. Now the third stage is the orthochromatic normoblast, or also known as the late normoblast. Here the chromatin is further more condensed, and the cytoplasm, it is grayish in color, and the nucleus is eccentric and it is ready to be extruded out of the cell. So this is the orthochromatic or late normoblast. Now after this, the nucleus gets extruded from the cell, and what we get a reticulocyte. Now reticulocyte is a young RBC, and it has got it does not have the nucleus, but it has ribosomes and RNA material. Now this young RBC, it is pumped into the peripheral blood circulation. It goes into the periphery, and there it remains for 2 days around, and then the spleen, it removes its the RNA and ribosomal material, and after that it matures into a mature RBC. So these are the various stages of RBC maturation. Now next we come to a normal RBC. So how a normal RBC looks like, it is also known as a normocyte. So RBCs which are produced by the bone marrow, they are biconcave. You see in the side profile, in the side we can see that this is biconcave. So in the center you can see these depressions and the bulge in the periphery. So in the center it is depressed, in the periphery it is bulged. So this is a biconcave. So in the side view we can see that it is biconcave, but when we see from the top, it is spherical in shape. It seems spherical. And also in this peripheral blood film, we can see that these are looking like the round in shape. So the central pallor, it is important that the central pallor is less than 1/3 of the diameter in a normocyte. So when the central pallor is less than 1/3, you can see this is a central pallor. When this is less than 1/3, then it is called as normochromic RBC. Now second important point is about the size of RBC. We should know that the size of RBC is 7.2 to 8.4 microns, and in a peripheral smear, how do we compare it? We compare it with the help of a nucleus of the small lymphocyte, because the nucleus of small lymphocyte has the same size as that of RBC So with that we can compare whether the RBC is normocytic or it is small in size, that is microcytic, or it is greater in size, that is macrocytic. And lastly, the lifespan of RBC is 120 days. Now, when we see a general blood picture, we should observe an area. We know that when we make a peripheral blood film, it is tongue shaped. So the area which we examine for the GBP, it is adjacent to the tail area. So in this area, the RBCs, they are just touching each other. They are adjacent to each other. While if we see the area which is near the tail, so in this area, the RBCs, they are far apart from each other and their morphology is not appropriate. You can see these RBCs. So we cannot comment on the morphology in the region of the tail. So we have to see the area which is adjacent to the tail. And also, in the area of the head. So this is the area of the head, and in that area we can see that there is lot of overlapping of the RBCs. So we should not examine the RBCs in the region of the head or in the region of the tail. The ideal area to examine is the region which is adjacent to the tail. So this is important while examining a GBP. Now, next, the very important terms that we should know before commenting on the various variations in the RBC morphology. First term is anisocytosis, a very important term. This is N means different. So iso is same. So the RBC size are not the same. N means not, iso means same. So the size of RBCs is not the same. This is anisocytosis, which is variation in the size. Now here you can see some RBCs are small, some are large, but they are round. All the cells are round, but they are small and large. So this is anisocytosis. And when we say there is anisocytosis in the machine, when we run the sample, we will see that the red cell distribution width, it is a measure of anisocytosis, so it will be increased. Normal range of RDW is 11 to 16%, RDW-CV. And RDW-SD is 35 to 56 femtoliters. So there are two ranges of RDW. In the exam, if some question comes, then either they can give you this range or this range. So you have to remember both. So 11 to 16% or 35 to 56 femtoliters. So when there is anisocytosis, there will be increased RDW. It correlates with the RDW. Now next is hyperchromia, very, very important. Now hyperchromia, normally the central pallor is less than one third of the diameter of the cell, but if it is more than one third, then we say that the RBCs are hypochromic. And a hypochromic RBC, it corresponds with a low mean corpuscular hemoglobin. Mean corpuscular hemoglobin is the total amount of hemoglobin in a single red blood cell. So normal value is 27 to 33 picograms, and it corresponds with the hypochromia corresponds with a low MCHC. So normal MCHC is 31 to 36%. So this is a percentage of the RBC in grams per deciliter. So these values are again important, because in a problem based question these values can come. So we should know the normal ranges. Now third term is poikilocytosis. So poikilocytosis is importantly, it is the variation in the shape of the RBC. So in this picture you can see that the shape of the RBC, now here it is round, but here you can see the variable shapes are there. Here it is teardrop, again here you can see teardrop, again here you can see a fragmented RBC. So there is variation in the shape of the RBC and it is known as poikilocytosis. So these three terms we should know. Anisocytosis, variation in the size, corresponds with RDW. Hypochromia is increased central pallor more than one third, corresponds with low MCH and MCHC. And poikilocytosis is the variation in the shape of the RBC. Now next we come to the first variation of normal RBC, that is microcytic hypochromic RBC. So the size of RBC becomes less than normal. And how do we know that? By comparing it with the size of the lymphocyte, small lymphocyte nucleus. So it will be lesser than, the size will be lesser than the nucleus of the small lymphocyte. So these are the microcytic cells. You can see that like this, these are the small sized RBCs. These are the microcytes and microcytic hypochromic cells. Hypochromia means central pallor more than one third of the cell diameter. Now, if a cell is microcytic, it corresponds with the mean corpuscular volume less than 80 femtoliters. So normal MCV is 80 to 100 femtoliters, and if it is a microcytic cells in the run of the sample, we will see that MCV is less than 80. Now the differential diagnosis is very important for microcytic hypochromic RBCs. There are four differentials, and we remember by the mnemonic SITA, S-I-T-A. So S stands for sideroblastic anemia, then I stands for iron deficiency anemia, T for thalassemia, and A for anemia of the chronic disease. So in iron deficiency anemia and thalassemia, we see in both the MCV will be less than 80 femtoliters, but there is an important index, that is Menzer's index, which is calculated by a formula MCV upon RBC in the millions. Now if this count is less than 13, then we are more sure of it being a thalassemia, case of thalassemia, while if it is more than 13, we call it iron deficiency anemia. Like there are more chances of it being iron deficiency anemia. Why? Because in IDA the RBC count is less, while in thalassemia it can be normal. So if it is less, so this value will be more than 13. So more than 13, it points towards the diagnosis of IDA, while less than 13, it can be thalassemia major or a trait. So this gives us a rough idea whether Menzer index, whether the case is that of IDA or thalassemia. In both the cases, MCV will be less than 80. In anemia of chronic disease, there is chronic inflammation going on in the body. There are numerous conditions which are causing the chronic inflammation, and because of that, the cytokines like TNF, interleukins, they are increased in the body, and that leads to the increased production of a protein which is called hepcidin. So what hepcidin does, hepcidin decreases the utilization of iron in the body. So iron is there, but body is not able to utilize that. So the stored iron, that is ferritin, and that is not utilized by the body, so results in a anemia. So now these are the figures showing the macrocytosis. So these are the macrocytes. In thalassemia, we can see the target cells. These are target cells, look like bullseye. So target cells are important finding. Again, differentiate between the IDA and the thalassemia. So more likely to be seen in thalassemia, target cells. Then in sideroblastic anemia, the sidrocytes are seen. These are laden with iron. So see that these are the we stain with the Persian blue stain. This stains the normoblast in the marrow, and in the marrow we can see these sideroblast. So these iron laden cells, they are demonstrated by the Persian blue stain. Now, in the microcytic hypochromic anemia, when we do differential diagnosis, the iron studies play a very, very important role, because in iron deficiency, there is a deficiency of iron in the diet. So either there is nutritional deficiency or there is decreased absorption, but there is deficiency of iron in the body. So the iron is reduced, ferritin, the storage form is reduced, the total iron binding capacity will be increased, and the percentage saturation of transferrin will be decreased. In anemia of chronic disease, the iron is not deficient, but its utilization is defective. So the ferritin will be normal, or even it can be increased, then iron will be reduced. TIBC can be normal or reduced, and percentage saturation is reduced. Now again, in the thalassemia, the diagnostic tool is the hemoglobin electrophoresis, because there is defective hemoglobin and the iron studies can be normal. Again, in the sideroblastic anemia, the iron studies will be normal. So the iron studies play an important role to differentiate in the various forms of microcytic hypochromic anemia. And in sideroblastic anemia, the Persian blue staining of the bone marrow, it can be an important diagnostic tool for the diagnosis. And in thalassemia, the hemoglobin electrophoresis. So this information is generally useful in solving the problem-based questions. Now next we come to the macrocytic RBCs. So macrocytic RBCs, now they are larger in size, so more than 8.5 microns. and they correlate with a mean corpuscular volume of more than 100 femtoliters. In microcytic RBCs, it was less than 80, and in macrocytic RBC, it is more than 100. Now, these cells are normochromic. So, MCH, MCSC will be normal. Now, important thing is that the megaloblastic anemia, generally most common cause of the macrocytic anemia, it can present with pancytopenia because there is a defect in the nuclear maturation. So it can affect all the lineages, the nucleus in all the lineages. So it can result in pancytopenia. And there can also be jaundice because the erythropoiesis is ineffective since the nuclear maturation is lagging behind the cytoplasmic maturation. So nuclear cytoplasmic asynchrony is there. So there is ineffective erythropoiesis in the bone marrow. So such erythroblasts, the precursor RBCs, they are generally, they get destroyed within the marrow only. So there can be increased hemolysis also of those RBCs. That can result in increased bilirubin and clinically presenting with jaundice. So pancytopenia and jaundice can be seen in the clinical presentation of the megaloblastic anemia, and this information can be useful to solve some the problem based questions. Now, in the megaloblastic anemia, which is basically due to the B12 and folate deficiency. Now, B12 folate is important for the nuclear maturation. And in this, we see the oval macrocytes like this. These are the oval macrocytes, oval. These are macrocytes which are oval in shape. While in the non-megaloblastic causes of macrocytic anemia, we see the round macrocytes. So, the non-megaloblastic causes of macrocytic anemias include liver disease, alcoholism, hypothyroidism. These are the important causes. While in the megaloblastic anemia, it is because of the B12 and folate deficiency. And how to differentiate between the megaloblastic and non-megaloblastic? In the megaloblastic anemia, we see the megaloblast in the bone marrow. So, bone marrow will show megaloblast. These megaloblasts, they are characterized by sieve-like chromatin. So, sieve-like chromatin is seen in the nuclei of the megaloblast, and this is the characteristic finding of the megaloblastic anemia. Additionally, in the peripheral smear, we see hypersegmented neutrophils. So how do we define hypersegmented neutrophil? So normally, the neutrophil has 3 to 5 lobes. If more than 5% neutrophils, they have 5 lobes, they have 5 lobes, or if even a single neutrophil has 6 lobes, then we call it as hypersegmented neutrophil. So these are important findings in case of a megaloblastic anemia. Now, next, spherocytes. So, spherocytes, normally I told you that the RBCs, they are biconcave. So, central depression is there. This is a biconcave RBC. But, these biconcave RBCs, they are very much flexible. When they pass through small capillaries and sinusoids in the spleen, they are quite flexible and they don't get destroyed or damaged. But, this flexibility of RBC is because of its membrane. And that membrane is maintained by certain proteins like ankyrin, spectrin, band proteins. So what happens in hereditary spherocytosis? There is mutation in these proteins. So there are certain genes which are regulating the formation of these proteins. So in hereditary spherocytosis, important, this gene which is coding for the ankyrin protein, it gets mutated. So there's a congenital defect and results in the small size rounded RBCs. Now, what is the problem with these rounded RBC is that these are less deformable. So when they pass through small capillaries or sinusoids in the spleen, they get easily damaged. So results in a hemolytic anemia, and their osmotic fragility is also increased. They are very much fragile and they are less deformable. So they pass through the sinusoids, then they get easily damaged. They are more rigid cells. And also they lack a central pallor, and because of water and potassium loss, they show dehydration, and there is increased MCHC. So all these points are very important for the hereditary spherocytosis, and the hereditary spherocytosis is the most important differential diagnosis of a spherocyte. So in this picture we can see these fully hemoglobinized cells. Now these are like the normal RBCs with a central pallor, and here you see these are the fully hemoglobinized cells. These are, and they are small in size. So these are the spherocytes. And hereditary spherocytosis, most important mutation causing it is the ankyrin. although other mutations also occur, spectrin, band proteins, but the most important one is enkyrin. And another important point for hereditary spherocytosis, generally problem-based question occurs. So in a child, the history will be given of splenomegaly, jaundice, and anemia. So this triad is generally given in the problem-based question. Now, we should also remember that that hereditary spherocytosis is not the only cause for spherocytes being seen in the peripheral smear. So what are the other causes for spherocytes? Other causes are autoimmune hemolytic anemia, then Clostridium perfringens septicemia, then physical or chemical injury. In case of severe burns, microspherocytes are seen. Then in ABO, hemolytic disease of the newborn. So important to know that it is not seen in RH hemolytic disease, but in the ABO hemolytic disease. And also in case of post-transfusion. So the spherocytes, they are very important if you observe it in the peripheral smear. So we can make out the following, these differential diagnosis. And then we can accordingly exclude each of them based on the other investigation and history. Now, lastly, the elliptocyte. So elliptocyte, in the length of RBC is more than twice of its breadth. And if more than 5% elliptocytes are seen in the peripheral smear, then it is significant. The cause of elliptocyte is hereditary elliptocytosis and in severe iron deficiency anemia. So important mutation in the elliptocyte, hereditary elliptocytosis, is the spectrin protein mutation. So this is again MCQ. Important that in hereditary spherocytosis, enkyrin protein is the one that is mutated, while in hereditary elliptocytosis, the spectrin protein is most commonly implicated. So S is not for S. So in HS, the enkyrin mutation is seen, and in HE, hereditary elliptocytosis, spectrin mutations, they are seen. So I'll be continuing this in the next lecture. Thank you.